Hello, everybody, and welcome back to my Let's Play of Aurora 4X. So, today is probably the episode that a lot of you who have been following me have been waiting for. Today, we go to war. So, at the moment, we know that there are hostiles in Cairns. All right, we went exploring. And we ran into them, and they were neutral at the time. But since then, communication has broken down, and our militaries have decided, no, we're going to kill each other. So, to that end, we have our combat fleet doing a bit of training, prepping up for some, prepping up for the upcoming, session of combat. Which hopefully will go our way because when we last saw them, they were traveling at 15,000 kilometers a second, which means their engines are going to be fairly powerful, and their missiles, if they have any, are potentially going to be a lot faster than ours. Still waiting on the steward at the moment, but that won't take much longer. How are we doing? Tarpaulin's training isn't going up at the moment. It's kind of annoying, but well. How are we doing on training? For some reason, task force training isn't going up. Forget it. We're just gonna have to work and deal with it. All right, head back to refuel. And Stuart is almost ready. Okay, so that is our fleet. So we set the speed to max. We're not going to take any of these. So let's get on our way. Okay. So what we need to do then is we need to ensure, before you go into combat, that you know it's coming. You need to make sure that your fuel is full, your ammo is 100% where required, because that means you have all your ammo. If your ammo is not 100%, you're obviously going to risk running out of ammo, which is a bad thing. Maintenance, make sure that's full as well. And obviously, your clock and crew months, you want to be relatively low, but not a big deal. Okay. Let's get underway then. All right, so we are back. It's now June 2057, so about a year later, but all of our ships have been refit into their latest and greatest selves. So that should stop any fuel issue. So two things happened in the meantime. The first one is that we found our first nebula down here in Ipswich. And if we go to Ipswich, there we are. It's a level 3 nebula. So it's got a maximum speed of 833 kilometers per second per layer of armor that a ship has. So the more armored it is, the faster it can go up to its top speed. The other thing is that Mars has completed its terraforming. So it is now perfectly habitable. Might as well set these as a source now and just let them grow on their own. So we have moved our terraformer over into Sydney, and that is going to slowly be chugging away at Sydney Prime. We'll move some mining across once we have some spare auto mines. So with that done, now we can go to war. So we'll first wait, let them refuel. There we go. One thing to note when you're refitting ships is that they will not automatically refuel as part of the refit. So if you're adding fuel to the ships, do make sure that you refuel them before you send them on their way. So we're going to Rocky and then Cairns jump point. So move the camera to Sol. There we go. Oh, and we may have left Antonio Betty a little bit too long out in the middle of nowhere. So, how far off is he? He is 2 hours out. He's almost home. Never mind. Wait for him to complete orders. There we go. Okay, now we get to find out, to confirm for sure on camera whether I'm right or wrong about the jump points, and there we go. So, as you can see, a combat squad, which includes a civilian ship, has successfully managed to transit using a military jump drive. So, let's move to Rocky. Where are we now? We're there, it's not going to take very long at all. Few days trip. There we go. So we will take. I'm gonna do this. Really neat trick. Because it sorts them alphabetically, if you put a space in front, it'll keep that group to the top, which will open by default when you open it for fresh. So that's handy. So we will take the press bar and detach it because it just needs to sit at the jump point. We'll make sure it's organized there. Now we also need to refuel. So, refuel from own tankers should be. Where is it? Is the warmonger not a tanker? Guess not. Oh well. Refuel from target fleet. And we'll take a little bit. There we go. Done. So, combat squad didn't refuel. Could not be completed. Why? Probably might be because it moved. Let's try it again. Oh, because it's out of fuel. Doi. Okay. So, yeah, this one chugs. Anyway, let's jump through Cairns and we'll see what's on the other side. So we set max speed, so it's going as fast as it can. 67 is still a little bit short, but that's just because of the Sheehans. They're a little bit on the slow side. We'll equalize fuel to make sure we have the same percentage. We will activate all of our sensors. We don't have any shields, so that's fine. So we will now jump through into Cairns, and we immediately detect them, and they're right on top of us. Okay, this is probably not going to end well. So let's go to combat. First of all, Warramunga. It's a scout ship, so it doesn't need any combat settings. So let's set up our rivers first. They should already be set up, but guess not. So, two turrets and two turrets. We assign them to final defensive fire and final defensive fire. This will make sure that they protect the fleet. And we copy assignment to all the ships in the fleet. So, final defensive, so the area defense, final defensive fire, and final defensive fire self only. With all these modes do fire automatically. You do not need to use automated fire for them. Same goes with our AMM launchers. You do not need to use automated fire for them. You assign them, you set the mode, and you leave it. Now we do need to 10,000 units. Close that. Refresh it. There we go. Million kilometers. Perfect. We set the PD mode. We'll set 3 at the moment. Now, for our ASM, we assign this, assign the ECCM to it. We'll unlock the arrows to these. There we go. We'll copy target. So, because we jumped through, we are suffering from jump blindness. Okay. That means that our active sensors are functionally offline. Ignore that they disappeared. Our active sensors are functionally offline, and our fire controls can't lock onto anything. So, because they're right on top of us, if they have any beam weapons, they're going to be able to shoot us without us being able to shoot at them. So, how do we get around that? Like this. We take our missile boats, okay, with our arrows. Our arrows have their own sensors, right? And missiles are not affected by jump blindness. Missile fire controls are, but missiles themselves are not. We haven't assigned any weapons to the AMMs. And the reason for this is because what we're going to do is we're going to drop our missiles into open space, and they're going to find the targets themselves. So if we now go to missile launch, go to 5 seconds. There they are. Ooh, how far are they? 9,000 kilometers. Okay. So, arrow E. So, there they are. Okay. They've launched. They've released. And now, they will randomly fly around in a nearby area until they can find the target. Because it's within range, and they are above the target range, the next step should be to circle around and slam into our targets, and we are going to immediately set to move a follow at a million kilometers, I think. Make it 10 million. Add move. There we go. Alright, so they'll turn and they'll start trying to move out of the way. So let's see what happens with the next tick. Boom. So let's see what we got. So as you can see, the arrow E turned around and intercepted the target. So missile intercept. So first up, we'll get the roll for the chance to hit. So, 15 arrow E's intercepted. The chance to hit was 87% with a missile speed of 27,700 versus a target speed of only 6,000 kilometers a second, which is a lot slower than the other guys were. So, there's probably more ships in the system. Then you multiply by the agility. This is actually the maneuver rating, not the agility. Because if you have a look at our missile design, the arrow E has an agility of 48, but the maneuver rating is what it should be, 18. So, maneuver rating of 18, and multiplied by the grade bonus. The grade bonus of the ship that launched the missile, which in this case is 0%. So, hit, it gives you an armor strength rating based on the damage. That one set is, it's not 100% accurate, so never really rely on it. So, hit. First salvo, all hits. Next salvo of 15. 87%. Almost all hits, only 4 of them missed. Another burst of 9 damage. Third salvo, hit, and kill. So, Destroyer Werewolf got the kill because it owned the salvo that actually scored the final blow. Now, because it's automated tracking with its active sensors, the next salvo realized that this ship was destroyed, the Magnolia 1 was destroyed, so it went straight after Magnolia 2 on the same instance, on the same tick. Hit, next salvo, hit, third salvo, kill. So from this, we know that it takes approximately 3 salvos to kill a Magnolia. And they also don't travel very quickly at all, or they were just caught really surprised. It does appear, if you have a look, secondary magazine explosion. So we know that these ships do have missiles as well. So with the secondary magazine explosion, we do know that they do have missiles, as obviously one of their magazines exploded. So that's a little bit of notice there. Now we get to see if they got any missiles off themselves. But it doesn't look like they did. Looks like we end up using all of our missiles as well, which is handy because we killed them off in the right time. So we'll skip ahead 5 minutes to wait for our active sensors. We'll remove that order because there's nothing to go. There we go. So after a few minutes, we have cleared our jump blindness and we can move on to see where we are. So we've used up 7% of our ammunition so far. So Cairns A5 is where we're going to. Let's move out. All right, now that we are not at point blank range, we will go ahead and set our AMMs for AMM duty. So set up Patriots and assign all. There we go, and copy assignment. Right. Now because remember, because they're in PD mode, they will automatically fire as appropriate based on that PD mode. You do not have to use automated fire. However, I will use synchronous fire because that will assure us that when it does fire a volley, they will all fire at the same time. So our ASMs will all fire at the same time. Every ship in the task group that has synchronous fire ticked will not fire until all ships with synchronous fire ticked are ready to fire. This is very important for missiles because you need the volleys to come in at the same time. If you stagger them, then queues will make a relatively short work of them. So that is important to keep track of. So how are we doing? There it is. Burgundy sky. Is that the new one? I believe that was the old one. Yes, that was the one we saw earlier. So that one's got the 15,000. It's got a cross section of 193, so it's fairly. So it's the same tonnage. So that's within our active search sensors. So we'll close in further. Go. So now it's within our missile fire controls, so we can lock onto it if we wish. And it's charging right at us. Hopefully, it comes within range of our arrows, and it looks like it will. Nope, it's going to sit outside of range. So we've got two options, right? The range for our arrows is. The range on our arrows is 135, but the minutes is 82, right? So in 1 hour, we are able to travel. So that's 20 minutes is that far. So 1 hour is probably going to be about that far. So if we're traveling away and it's chasing us, we could potentially hit it. So let's try that. So we'll stop. We'll turn around. And we'll see if it will chase us. Doesn't look like it will. At least not at this range. Are we getting any slowdown? No, we're not. All right, so it's following us at 227 million kilometers. This could be problematic. Okay. So first things first, we need to figure out if it's shooting any missiles at us, right? So we'll turn around, we'll head back to Cairns A5. Now, actually, very quickly, our AMMs only have 1.8 million kilometers, but just double check that range. Range is 10k units is really annoying. So multiply it by 10, so you get 10,000. Ugh. 10,000 times 1,000. So that's 10 million kilometers. That is way outside the range of our AMMs. So we only have about 1 million kilometers. So we set it to 100. Yeah, 100. That's 1 million kilometers. So that should be. Let's set it to 1.8. There. And we'll copy the assignment. There we go. 1.8 million kilometers. Keep moving. So it looks like that ship is not firing any missiles. It might just be following us. But there's a Sunshine Daydream. That's a new one. Not sure what that one is, but it's definitely closing. It is, however, slower than us. So what we'll do is we'll close to range and get ready to open fire. So clear that. Follow it at 100,000, 1 million, 10 million, 100 million. Follow it at 100 million kilometers range. Yeah, we confirm their speed. We have fire controls. Lock. Right, this one's definitely going to be firing missiles, so we'll see how their missiles go. We should be detecting them shortly, and we can close range with them. Yeah, we are slowly closing range. About 500,000 kilometers every 2 minutes. Looks like they're both closing again now. So Burgundy Sky is moving in. If it gets within range and decides to stay there, then we're definitely going to hit it in the face with a couple of missiles. Ooh, there they are. So we'll make sure that the AMMs are not doing anything unusual. Tell them to open fire. We've got the. Why has that range changed? Okay, now it is set to correct. 3 versus 1, 1.8. Should be 1.8. Oh, yeah, because it's not within range yet. So they're doing 36,000. Our AMMs are actually, I think, slower than that. So this could be problematic in terms of shooting down with AMMs. So missiles. Yeah, we're only doing 28, which means that our missile AMMs are not going to be hyper effective. There we go. Missiles launch. We do have these on area defense. Final defensive fire, point blank mode, not self only. Good. There's 16 of them as well. So we'll see how that plays out. Alright, intercept. What's our accuracy? 48 intercepted, 9 hit. So that is, we're going to need more. Turn around and head back. We want to move back because if we're moving away from the missiles, then we're going to get more time to shoot at them, in theory. So second volley out, intercepted. 5 more hits. And 2 more. Two of them looks like they got shut down by the Gauss. So we've got a 55% tracking. Okay, so just going to do a little quick math, and we'll show you how the tracking speed works on the guns. So if you have a look, right? So fire control is tracking speed. So FC and guns as well. Tracking speed is 16,000. Okay. And we're firing at 10,000 kilometers range. 10,000 kilometers range. And we've got a target speed of 37,000. Missile speed of 37,000. Okay. So we have here base chance to hit 128% with a so we have a base hit of 96 with a crew grade of 128%, right? So it takes the 196 multiplies by 128, so you got the base chance of 28. Well, 28 is after the 96 has been modified by crew grade. Okay, so you've got missile speed divided by tracking speed. Okay, at 10,000 range, it's basically like 98% accurate. You only lose like 1 or 2% accuracy on the fire controls, right? obviously, if you have longer range, then you're going to lose less than if you have a short range fire control, but that's fine. So, no, maybe it was the other way around. Ah, there we go. Okay. So that's our accuracy based on range, right? So because we're firing at almost zero, our base chance to hit is 96%. Crew grade modifies it up to 128. Okay. However, because we're firing at against a target that's faster than our tracking speed, then that gives us an accuracy penalty down to 43%. So we take 128% of our hit rate. So hit chance at range is 128. And we go this times this gives us 55%. See? Now, so this also confirms that even at lower tech levels, the missile tracking bonus does not apply at all. So you'll see, right, that all this calculation only is based only on tracking speed, range, missile speed, right? I have not factored the tracking bonus at all in the slightest, and we are getting accurate hit chances. We have a 40% tracking bonus. So what should happen is that this should get plus 40% accuracy, which means that we should be able to shoot down every single one of these missiles using nothing but a point defense, right? We should not need AMMs at all with the 40% tracking bonus that we've got. But because we don't have that, because it doesn't apply, we only have a 50% accuracy. And that will need to be rectified. But I'm not sure if Steve has responded yet, so might have to poke him on that and see what it says. But we do know at least that our point that our Gauss cannons are very capable of shooting down the missiles, right? We have four of them on each ship, and we have six of those, so we have 24 turrets, and they're twin turrets, so we have 48 Gauss guns. So even with a 55% accuracy with tracking speed, we are still able to shoot down 24 missiles, and the salvos are only 16, right? So in theory, we can turn off our AMMs entirely, save the ammo on there, and probably just tank it outright, you know? So what I might do is, until further notice, is I'm going to reduce the AMMs to 2 to conserve a bit of ammo. Might even just go 1. And range is 180. Okay. We'll conserve a bit of ammo and we'll set it to 1 only. This way, we'll still shoot down a few and reduce the salvo size, but we'll let the guns take care of that primarily. So, we'll see what happens. Plus, with the lower speed, we'll see if it actually happens, but there is a... There you go. See that? So, within that tick, the intercept didn't actually occur at all, right? So, because it didn't occur, the AMMs have turned around and have started following their targets. But the problem is that they're slower than them, which means that they will never, ever, ever catch up. So the only thing I can do now is destroy them all, because there's no point. And because they are still AMMs chasing the missile, the launchers will not fire a new volley, right? Oh, what happened there? Missile self-destructed. What? Okay, that's a potential bug. Put that in the reminder. Okay. Anyway, let's get back to it. So... 100,000, million, 10, 100 million. So we'll continue following at 100 million, and we'll see... Huh. Well, that is a very interesting and potentially game-breaking bug. It looks like if you hit destroy all, it destroys all the missiles in the entire system, even if they're not yours. That is fun. Okay. Sure, why not? Let's catch up to Sunshine Daydream then. It's not really a problem at the moment because we have done the math and we were able to just tank through all those missiles. It really doesn't make a difference in the outcome. We would have survived, we would have hunted them down, and we'd be in this exact same situation. It would just be half an hour of video of tanking through a whole bunch of missiles. Well, not half an hour, but you know, however long it is. Well, let's keep closing. Alright, so it's now within range of our arrows, but obviously because it's got an 80-minute flight time, it'll run out of fuel before it actually reaches it. So we need to ensure that it is close enough that the missiles are still able to actually catch it. So we'll wait until it's about this range, and then we'll fire it then. Hopefully we won't get shot at by their planet, if they have one. Okay, so they do have Nico Blue and Mountain Peace, which are further 19,000-ton ships. They haven't come at us at the moment, so they might not be. There might not be military ships, or there could be something completely different, or there could be fight, or there could be carriers, which is potentially scary. So let's close in faster. We're catching you. What I could do is I could take the rivers and send them after it, because they're much faster. They could catch it. Ooh, what's happening there? Missiles? Yeah, that looks like missiles. I would say that those two are missile boats. They're smaller than the Daydream, though, so. They're definitely longer ranged. There they are. Yeah, they're just more missiles. Oh, we get to do another round of point defense. Boom. Three interceptions, shaved it down to 13. Excellent. And another round. Intercepted another four. So, point defense, how are they doing? little bit of wastage there. Two opens fire, four destroyed. Yeah, so every second, so pretty much one turret will shoot down one missile. So, and we have plenty of turrets on the fleet. Okay, more interceptions, more another interception, and all shut down. Beautiful. No interception, but. Shut down by Gauss. All shut down. Yeah, so there we go. We'll just grind through. We still don't know how powerful the missiles are either, though. Because none of them actually hit us yet. Yep, that's what's missed. Point defense is good. Now, there is something I do need to check real quick. So, we've got. Here we go, Pixie. Okay, so because there was a comment about it. So what have we got? We've grade points, 150.3 grade points for the ship, right? So and this is for the which one was it? It was the Pixie, right? Yeah. So Pixie is 150.3. Sheehan is 425.9. Unicorn is 394.2. Werewolf is 100 exactly. Wyvern is 100 exactly. So they all seem to be very fresh. And Yeti is 100 exactly. So we'll see how much those have actually changed through combat. Because the crew grade bonus is extremely important when it comes to accuracy, because you'll notice that, you know, the missile accuracy is increased by grade bonus, right? And that does become extremely important, especially when you are dealing with missiles that are a little bit faster than yours, you know? And even with targets in general, that extra accuracy can mean the difference between a shot missing and a shot hitting, and then that final hit being able to, you know, take out the target, right? So it does become very important. I hope they run out of missiles soon. Yeah, so this is the slow grindy part of Aurora, where you have to slowly grind your way through enemy missile volleys. Thankfully, once they run out, then you don't have to worry about it anymore, and you can just fly in and blow them away. But it's a good thing that we didn't break off our beam ships and send them in to take out the target. Otherwise, they would be the ones getting shot at, and they don't have the point defenses required to shoot down these missiles. I mean, sure, they got a couple of beams, but they don't really have the accuracy for it. Okay, looks like it's a last volley. There we go. Alright, now I'll do a quick double check, a quick check of the 150.3, 425.9. Okay, so it looks like firing missiles under point defense didn't do anything. So that doesn't give it to you, so. MM launches. No. Shooting down missiles. No. So let's keep closing on Daydream. Although it looks like it's closing on us, and I'll actually get it to close a little bit closer into Daydream. Follow it to ten million kilometers. Yeah, he's definitely not going to get away this time. All right, Pixie, Sunshine, Daydream. Broken Sky is still within detection range, and it's still within fire control range, but we're not going to catch it because that's out of our arrow range. Keep in mind that this only shows you a target that you can lock onto, not necessarily targets you can hit. So we'll copy the target. So everybody's locked onto Daydream, and we will open fire. There. So we know that that's firing and that's all locked on. Preparing. So we should see that. Who's got the task force training? So Shin is probably going to lock on first, and Wyvern and Yeti are probably going to lock on last. So we'll see what the difference is. Interesting. It's the other way around. Oh well. All right, missiles out. And we'll cease fire. Now, personally, I prefer to fire only a single volley unless I know, as long as I don't know for sure exactly what we're dealing with, because with a single volley, right, you get a okay idea on their anti-missile capabilities, and at the same time, you get an idea of, more missiles incoming. You also get an idea of their point defenses, but without wasting missiles if it turns out that their point defenses are too much for you to handle. Size 4 missiles. That looks like it's going to be. No, we can handle those. Think they're even slower than the other ones. Yeah, so it looks like Sunshine Daydream has a couple of a few short-range missiles. AMM's firing. How are we doing on ammo? Oh, we're starting to run out of ammo. Pixie and Sheen have been firing all the missiles, and now Unicorn's starting to run low. But yeah, our turrets are more than capable of handling them, so not a problem. Okay, at this stage, I think I'm just going to turn off point defense mode because it's just wasting missiles at the moment. Our point defenses are more than capable of handling it, so we'll just let them do their job. Better double check that they have actually. Stopped. No, it's still in PD mode. Okay. That should stop any more from firing. Because the missiles don't really have the accuracy. Hit, 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 hit. All shot down. Good. And now we can use 30-second intercepts. Yep, all shot down. Yep. Okay, almost hit. Our own missiles are closing in. And boom. That is a devastating strike right there. So, point defense has shot down all of theirs. So, what do we got? So three of them shut down by point blank defensive fire. So they've obviously got either Qs or defensive turrets. However, accuracy is 87%, and with that many missiles, they just did not stand the chance. So destroyed. Looks like Pixie got the final score. Excellent. Let's go check the scores. Pixie is 150.3, 150.3, and okay, so getting kills is a no. But Sunshine Daydream has been destroyed, and with it, all of the missiles that it has fired cease to have a lock and self-destruct. There we go. That is sorted. Let's keep moving on to Cairns A5. Ground force contact. Do we have a thing in Cairns A1? No, we do not. Ground forces. That's interesting. All right, Cairns A1 will drop a colony. Hopefully, they won't attack an empty colony. But let's move along. We'll keep closing. Well, much within range of Mountain Peace and Nico Blue. They're within range. We'll close a little bit further. That'll do. They don't seem to have spotted us, or they're ignoring us outright. So, Mountain Peace, assign all targets. Open fire. We'll just stop the combat fleet so they don't accidentally trigger any AMMs or anything like that. There we go. Launch. And we will swap to burgundy blue. Targets. Or burgundy sky. And this is why reload times up to 5 minutes are not necessarily a problem, right? Because essentially, right? Essentially, a few minutes is only going to make a difference when you're at point blank range, right? I mean, most enemies are not going to shoot missiles at you for further apart than 30 seconds to a minute, right? A hostile weapon launch is not really going to be viable in less than 30 seconds. So if you have your AMMs firing every 30 seconds, you're not necessarily losing out on anything, you know? So that's just something to keep in mind. No, fired at the wrong thing. That one's going to be wasted. Okay. Right, so which one is this one we're gonna nail? Oh, they've got AMMs. Wow. Okay. So they have some pretty intense, probably lasers. Yeah, area defense lasers, and this is where that 2 minute time frame is going to be a problem, because now what we can do is we can actually split the launchers a bit. All right, what are we going to do now? How far out were they? They were probably about there, right? Kilometers. Let's have a look at some missile designs. No warhead. No agility. Reduce fuel to 47. Yeah, that's not bad. They'll never get close enough. Right, so what are we going to do? We could try and close in, or we could open fire en masse. So what we can do is we can actually close in and do a kind of combination move. However, fuel is starting to, well, fuel's fine, but ammo is starting to get a little bit on the low side, lower than I'd like. So what we might do is we might try a full barrage and see where that gets us. The other question is, are we going to be shooting at the mount at Mountain Peace or Nico Blue? I'm going to vote for Mountain Peace because, you know, why not? And what I might do, yeah, let's do that. All ships open fire on Mountain Peace. And we'll see where that gets us. Yeah, so slow launchers are useful against against targets that you can easily hit that don't have very good point defenses. Fast launchers are much more important when you're trying to overcome point defense. So we might have to go back and get some faster launchers on these, or potentially even faster missiles. But there is another way that you can kind of cheat them, right? So the way it works is, right, a missile enters point defense range, and the weapon decides the fire control on that when the missile starts the tick inside fire control range, that fire control will decide, oh, I need to shoot at this missile, and then it's going to open fire. However, if the missile never actually starts a tick within fire control range, then it's never going to get to fire. So if we skip to 20 minutes, look at that. It's closed within range, and it should be able to get in there and hit. Bam! It has completely bypassed the point defenses because it never actually started its turn within range of fire control. Either that, or they just completely ignored it. So missiles, yeah, closing in. And they've taken out the Mountain Peace. Now they're going for Nico Blue. How many more missiles do we have? Plenty. Yeah, so this one's, you know, doing its thing, but if we do 2 minutes, well, it's actually launched its missiles already. The important thing is that you need to skip bypass the missile launch phase. So you need to be able to skip outside of their from outside of their AMM to inside of their AMM. So if we do 5 minutes from here, there. It's a point blank range. AMMs have missed it. Next tick, that'll destroy them. Boom. And that's it. And that is how you cheap your way past point defenses. So Obviously, this is extraordinarily cheap and it is a total exploit of the game mechanics. Don't do it ever. I'm warning you, don't you dare. But that's how it's done. So what we need to do now is we need to hunt down that burgundy sky bastard, but we are out of missiles and it's not going to be practical. However, we do have six rivers and we do have three Sheehans which still have ammo. So what I will do is I'm going to hope that this burgundy sky is just a scout ship, and we're going to do something a little bit risky. So but let's do a little bit of organization. So we're going to add combat squad. I'll reorganize this later, but for now, this will do. So, of the combat squad, we have Destroyer Alpha, Destroyer Bravo, Destroyer Charlie. And missile destroyer. So under destroyer alpha, we will add the bat and the osprey. Under Bravo, we will add the ostrich and the peacock. And under Charlie, we will add owl and parrot. For the missile destroyer, we will use the werewolf, the wyvern, and the yeti because they actually still have any actual ammo. They'll need to close within point blank range because it's only AMMs, but they actually have ammo. So what we'll do with these split off, Warmonger will just detach you straight up. Actually, no. We'll put you back in. Put you back in. Empty, so get rid of it. We'll do this by organization. So we also need AWACS, which is the Warmonger. So we'll add that Warmonger in there. Okay. Pixie Sheen and Unicorn. You know what? We'll rename this to Missile Destroyer Alpha. And we'll also add a new one, Missile Destroyer Beta. Oh, bravo. So, destroyer. Bravo. And we'll put the other three in there. The Pixie, the Sheehan, and the Unicorn. That way they'll be in their own thing. We don't have to worry about where they've been left over. So, that is fine. So, what do we do with organization? Okay, what is it actually for? This is what it's for. AWACS. Create a new task group containing all ships in the currently selected branch. They're in the same location as currently selected task group. Top left of this window. So what this basically means is I can hit branch only, and it will split off the AWACS into a task group called AWACS. Right? You can name the task group before it actually happens. Right? Probably would have been wise to put a space in the front, but there we go. That way it sits at the top. So if we actually refuse, it refuses. And what we can do is, right, with AWACS, if you notice, if we now go to combat squad, right, it should have picked up the subordinate ones, but should have sent a subordinate. Not sure why it hasn't. We'll set combat. There we go, spear formation. And if we actually combine, there we go. So that's rewelded them. So if we go to AWACS, we'll do So we can do branch only, right? Which will split off all of the, which will split off the selected group into its own task group, right? Ship only will split, will basically do exactly the same as split. So that's the problem. However, if you have a look, branch and sub, creating a new task group containing all shifts in the current selected branch and all sub branches in the same location. So if we now do combat squad and do branch and sub, that doesn't do what I expected. But anyway, so branch. And we go to a space in the front. Okay, so combat squad. Then we do destroy alpha branch. Destroy Bravo branch. Charlie branch. Destroy Alpha branch and destroy Bravo branch. So now we have all of our combat groups that are basically sitting in separate groups, right? And that allows you to easily and quickly split off groups from one another. So Bravo, you're out of ammo. So you head over to, you head back to the jump point, right? But Alpha, what we'll do is, now we will maneuver to catch Burgundy Sky in a bit of a trap and see if we can get it to squeal. So for that, we are going to need waypoints. So we're going to add a waypoint here, add a waypoint here, and we're going to add a waypoint here. So I can say where it is. So destroy alpha will go to waypoint 1 and then move on to waypoint 3. Destroy Bravo will move to waypoint 2 and Charlie will move to waypoint 1 only. All right. So this thing is substantially faster than we are. Our missiles can catch it, but our destroyers can't. So what we're going to do is we're going to try and swing around and get behind it without necessarily alerting him or pissing him off. But it does appear that he is moving to try and avoid one of them. Well, if we can figure out which one it is, we can use that to force him to maneuver. So it's going to be Alpha or Charlie. Alpha, change your movement to waypoint 2. Does he turn? Yes. Okay. So Alpha is the one that moves. So what we'll do is Alpha will actually stand still. Okay. Now it's switched to Charlie. Charlie. Move to waypoint 3. You know what? I've got a better idea. Let's make ourselves a small fighter. A fighter that will be able to chase this guy down and stick a couple of missiles up his tailpipe. That's what we'll do in the next episode. Thank you for watching. Hope you enjoyed the fight. We'll be back tomorrow.